Hi, thanks for tuning back to another Fireside Chats. I'm your host, Jeremy. We're here with special guests today. We're missing two, but that shouldn't really matter.
I'm JT from the last podcast.
I'm Danny from the last podcast.
And Donovan and Daniel should be joining us later tonight, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, but we have a special guest tonight, Mr. Mike Pollock.
Hi there, thank you so much.
So, Mike, how's your day been so far?
So far, so good.
Yeah. So, first question, what was one of your favorite moments in your career?
Probably seeing the first episode of Sonic Boom on TV.
Oh, nice. So, yeah, what was that experience for you? Like, how was that?
It was fascinating to see how they took our little raw recordings and animated them and turned them into magical moments.
Kind of like, that kind of reminds me of like Pixar. A little bit, yeah. Just like the way they make it and they form it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Take lemons and turn them into lemonade.
Yeah. Okay, so which Sonic title was your most favorite or memorable that you've worked on?
Also probably Sonic Boom, because it's the gift that keeps on giving.
So, yeah, why is that? Why is it the gift that keeps on giving?
52 11-minute episodes.
Oh, yeah.
A year of reasonably steady work.
That sounds pretty good. So since you're an actor, what do you think was the best performance you've seen in the movie this year? Animated, live action, can be whatever.
That's a fascinating question. Probably most surprisingly would have been Will Ferrell in the Lego movie, since I'm not generally a fan of Will Ferrell.
Oh, same here.
My friend Danny here is not a big fan of him either.
I don't like that guy.
I didn't want to like him. He was surprisingly good in parts.
Alright, so what inspirational events in your life would you say that truly helped you in your future career?
I hate to say it was sitting home watching TV, but it was probably sitting home watching TV.
Really? Wow, that's actually pretty fascinating to actually know that. Because a lot of people, they go to, like, classes and they, like, learn certain things. Like, and then they get, you know, influenced to be that certain, like, role, like either a doctor or...
I just watch a lot of cartoons, and once you watch a lot of cartoons, it's like, oh, that voice is awesome. And just, yeah, that voice.
Kind of resonates. Yeah. Just kind of sticks.
Yeah. Taking little bits of the acting and paying attention to what's going on, saying, oh, I see what he did there. That was an interesting choice. Look at that. And then combining that with various classes and training along the lines, but... realizing that probably the most earliest experience is not only wacky character voices that I heard in the radio, but I also heard on TV and cartoons.
Now, Danny and Jeremy, aren't you guys sort of like that too? Because I always hear you guys like memorize like almost every line from a cartoon. And I'm just like, how do you guys do? My friend Jeremy, like, he's pretty good with voice acting too. Like, I've told him more than once, I'm like, dude, you got to do something with it. And he's like, I don't know.
Yeah, I got years of practice.
But besides doing voice acting for Sonic television shows and games, what other shows have you worked on that you thought were fun to be a part of? And also, I'm sorry, what were you going to say?
No,
okay, and I guess it's a two-part question, but what other characters have you voice acted for?
The several years of stuff that I did for 4Kids Productions, as much as the fans hated them, I had great fun working on them.
So yeah, that's true. I remember that.
Ultimate Muscle, where I played Meat, Kirby Ride Back At You, I was the mayor, and Samo the bartender, Go-Go Riki, I was Big O'Riki, I was on the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, a couple of bit parts, playing the cartoonist Kirby, and playing the Garbage Man.
Oh, dude, do you remember that? They killed him off, though, he's like in one episode.
Mm-hmm. It was two episodes, actually.
Oh, okay, my bad.
Could have been a third, that didn't happen. Bonaparte in Yu-Gi-Oh! GX. All of the folks there were a pleasure to work with, a pleasure to work for. So that was lots of fun. And various commercials that I've done. I just did a recent spot for Pepsi. I did Think for Fat for Pop Chips with Katy Perry. I played a character called Fat Cat. That was also fun to do. All my work is fun because not working is not fun. And I'm a freelancer, so all actors are freelancers, so you never know where your next paycheck is coming from. So every job is a precious gift.
Yeah, wow. That's very cool. So how was it doing radio when you were in the business? And would you possibly ever go back into doing radio again?
Radio back then, which for me was the mid-80s, early 90s, is a different place than radio today. American radio has consolidated so that there's only a couple of big companies running the show, and they've taken out a lot of the fun and spontaneity. So there are very few places where the radio that I grew up with still exists. So if I could go back to radio in the mid-80s and have fun with my mid-80s radio friends again, that I would do. There are some friends of mine who are still working in radio, and I would happily be a guest on their show to talk about stuff like Sonic Boom if they were to invite me. But as far as a full-time radio gig, I don't think that would be in the cards for me right now.
Okay. That's good, though. What voice actors do you think do a great job at what they do, and why? Like, examples kind of like Troy Baker, how he's kind of like everywhere in a lot of video games. Roger Craig Smith, which I guess he's the voice of Sonic. And Peter Dinklage, who I guess voiced the Ghost Companion from Destiny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's also the Imp, Game of Thrones.
Oh, he is?
Yeah.
Okay. But yeah, so yeah, what other voice actors do you think do a good job of what they do?
My frame of reference is either people that I've worked with or people that I've heard while my children have been forcing me to watch cartoons on TV. And the folks that I know more about are the people that I've worked with. And it's just a joy for me to listen to very talented people do what they do. And most of the people that I've worked with, I will call the current Sonic cast as perfect examples, are extremely talented at what they do. And to me, the sign of a talented person is a person who knows how to have fun even when they're messing something up horribly. So in all cases, when we record Sonic Boom and outtakes happen, we're pretty much all laughing throughout the room because everybody's having a tremendous amount of fun, whether they're doing a perfect bang-up job or just a perfectly banked-up job. So I will go with the folks that I've worked with, both my new California friends for Sonic Boom and my New York friends from the 4Kids days.
Very cool. Okay, yeah. So what would be a show that you would personally like to voice act for or just work on?
Anyone at all. I love working.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
I would like something big and theatrical, like some big animated film that could get nominated for an Oscar. Or in the case of the Lego movie, not necessarily get nominated.
Yeah, that was weird.
That's a discussion for another time. But yeah, something big and theatrical or something big in primetime TV. But beyond that, I'm not real picky because I love working.
All right. So, during your career, have you met anyone that you would consider famous, I guess?
Fame is such a strong word. I mean, many of the people that I work with are famous within circles of people who watch the shows. But I don't consider myself famous when I'm out on the street and people have no idea who I am, which in most cases is a good thing. But if you ask the average guy bopping down the street who the hell I am, they will have no idea. However, there are random people who do know me in unexpected situations. My brother was going through a TSA checkpoint at the airport, and the TSA screener noticed his last name and said, "Hey, do you know Mike Pollock?" And my brother said, "He's my brother." And the TSA agent said, "Wow, he's great. He's great, Dr. Eggman. Tell him he's great, Dr. Eggman." So, okay, the TSA guys knew who I am. So there's that. But beyond that, I work with people who are famous among people who watch these shows, but as far as real live mega celebrities, not really.
Okay. What would you guys consider like someone to be famous? Like, what's your...
We're famous around this group, like, you know me, I know you, and they're like, we're good friends. That's what I see with famous, like, money and that. Yeah.
I think so also. So, when recording, where do you do your job? Like, for example, with voice acting for Eggman and Sonic Boom, Rise of Lyric, the game, would you go to the big red button to record, or would you go to, like, the same studio, like, you would do voices for the Sonic video games?
Generally, as long as I'm here, it doesn't matter where here is, but all those shows are recorded in a recording studio. Most of the animation companies and game-making companies don't have professional recording studios of their own, so they just rent time and rent an engineer, and they tell us where to show up, and the talent shows up. So in this case, I'm usually recording it in a New York studio. The rest of the gang are in an LA studio, and we are communicating in real time over the internet. And on very rare occasions, they will send for me to visit LA, and I get to record with the whole gang in LA. But in most cases, that's unnecessary.
Okay. Let's see. Okay, so what do you think of the recent announcement of there being a Sonic movie in production? And do you think you'll be reprising your role as Dr. Eggman in this film?
I have no idea what the future holds. I'd love to be a part of it if they'll have me, but it's not really up to me. It's up to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it'd be a good idea if they probably got you for that role, because I've been doing it for... how long have you been doing, like, the voice acting for Eggman?
11 years.
Wow.
That's a long time.
Dang, yes. That's impressive, though, because, I mean, like, some people, like, they only last, like, not that long, which, you know... That's pretty good. So where do you think your career will take you next with your voice acting skills?
Again, no idea what the future holds. I'm constantly auditioning for stuff. I've auditioned for stuff since the year began, at least a dozen auditions so far since the 1st of January. I've booked one or two of those, and I keep hoping that I'll be booking the next one. But again, never know. That's up to the casting director.
Right. Now, do you have any experience with that, like in the past, like having to wait for like an opportunity to come up?
Always. That's what my entire day is.
Yeah.
Various agents and managers sending me auditions. I respond back by submitting something for the audition. And once it leaves me, it's out of my hands, and I hope that the client likes it. Sometimes they do.
Now, like is that ever stressful? Because you always have to be on your toes, like trying to see for things, like, you know, coming up or...
The actual work. When you get the work, that's the fun of trying to get the work. That's the work. So yeah, you get used to rejection, but you also got to remember that as an actor, most of your life is rejection, because you're competing against tens or dozens or hundreds of people with the same role, and they can only choose one, and odds are against you. So chances are it's not going to be you. When it is, that's what makes every job you book a precious gift.
Has there ever been a moment where, like, you auditioned for a certain character, but they didn't feel like you were good for that one, but they liked you to play, like, another character?
I mean, once in a while. I mean, very often I'll go in and read for multiple things. So, I guess if I read for five different characters, then I have a five times better chance.
Yeah, that's true.
Now, Danny, did you have some questions you wanted to ask?
Oh, yeah. Who was the first character you ever played?
Third grade, I played a Roman. Does that count?
Yeah.
That counts.
Who's your favorite character to play as?
Voices that make me laugh. So, for example, I was Ella the Maid in Sonic X. The fact that they cast me for Ella the Maid, that makes me laugh.
That's so funny. Oh, my gosh. So you say you like doing voice acting for Sonic Boom because it's, you know, it makes you laugh and stuff like that. It's just like a good vibe overall. So in terms of like serious voice acting you've ever done, like how does that differ? Like the tone, the idea, the just all of it.
That's the magic of acting, is that you never know what each role is going to be about. And part of the challenge is finding out what the script is and how to interpret it. So I'm fully prepared and qualified to act in any genre. I've done comedy, I've done drama, I've done musicals, and I am happy to rise to whatever challenge I'm given. So if the director has cast me in something and wants me to be in something, I will give them the best damn performance I can, whether it's comedy or drama. I probably will be laughing more during a comedy, but even with a drama, there is fun stuff that goes on behind the scenes. So either way, even if it's straight drama and there's no laughs, the challenge of pleasing the director and pleasing the producer makes every job fun, at least to some degree.
Have you ever been in a situation where the work environment is not what it should be? Like, because I know with a lot of jobs people have, it's like their boss is like kind of messed up. Like their boss either messed up to them or they treat them well. Has there been like any, you know, event where you're like, okay, like I don't want to do this just because of this person or whatever?
There have been directors that are less than friendly when you work for them. There are some events that have not been organized as well as they could be.
Right.
But in most cases, I won't refuse to do a job. Occasionally, the subject matter is so crazy and wacky and out there and defensive in one way or another that I'll refuse to do it in the first place. But I don't recall a situation where I started working on something and haven't finished it.
Okay. So, now going back to the serious acting really quick. So games like Sonic the Hedgehog 2006 and I think, Sonic Unleashed. Because I think Dr. Eggman in Unleashed was serious, but wasn't as serious as he was in the Sonic the Hedgehog. So how did you transition into, like, a serious tone in Unleashed, but, like, not so serious, I guess, from the previous title?
Once I got the script, which was when I walked into the studio and had a moment to read it, and I noticed, okay, this has got a bit of a darker tone than usual, or a bit of a lighter tone than usual. I just make adjustments when I'm on the fly. I wish I could explain it better than saying it's the way I hear things in my head, and hopefully my mouth translates them into sounding the way they sounded in my head, but I have a fairly good grasp of script reading and script interpretation, and I can figure out, oh, this is what the writer was intending here, this is what the writer was intending here. Let me make sure I'm giving it to you. And then the director's job is to make sure that either they're telling me what they want in the first place, or they're letting me do something and liking what I do, or giving me notes and adjustments to change it and make it sound the way they want it to.
Okay. That's actually really cool how you're able to do that kind of stuff, because I know a lot of people who do try and do voice acting or just acting in a certain situation, like, it's just hard. Like, for me, like, I can't, like, do that. It's just, like, whatsoever. But, you know, with things like, I guess, just with things acting, I just can't do that. But that's really cool.
Everybody has their own skills.
Yeah, no, that's true. So, what other video games have you voice acted in besides Sonic the Hedgehog games?
Muscle when it was first released, the Viva Pinata TV show that I was in. The Viva Pinata game, I was in a couple of those. There were a couple of forgettable games for mobile devices that I'm part of. And I was some circus star game years ago that I don't remember why it existed, but
that's pretty funny. So, if there was one thing that was, like, I guess, like, if there was, like, one, like, okay, if there, like you said, like, with, like, the animation stuff, if a movie were to come up and they called you, maybe, like, Disney or DreamWorks for, like, I don't know, like, CGI movies like Transformers or just, like, I don't know, Shrek 4 or something, Shrek 5, Shrek. Like, would that be, like, something you're, like, okay, I can do that. That's definitely something I'd be into.
I would audition for anything.
So right.
I would leave it up to them to decide whether I can do it or not.
Okay.
I would be stupid not to try it.
Yeah.
So, Jeremy, did you have a question at all, or?
It's basically what you said and a couple of the questions I was going to ask.
Okay. So, when it comes to doing, like, when you're reading the script, do you have to, like, prep yourself? Like, do you have to, like, you know, like, practice, I guess, in a way, before, like, you start recording, or do you just do it off the fly?
I can do either. Cold reading is the technique of reading something for the first time and making the magic happen. I can usually do that. If I happen to get the script in advance, which is rare, I'll at least read through it and find my lines and highlight them so I know when I'm showing up the next day to record something, my lines are already marked and it's one less thing to think about. But in most cases, there is little to no prep time available. You walk in, you see the script, here's your script, and go. Take a minute, read it over, and go. But time is money, and time is short, and there very often is little time to play.
So, like, for auditions, they don't give you time to, like, practice at all?
You get there, you try to get there about 10 minutes before your appointed time. You can give yourself a little extra time by picking up the script before you actually sign in, so they don't really know you're there yet. But once you sign your name, then the clock starts running because they're gonna see the people ahead of you, and just like at the doctor, when your number's up, you're next in the room.
Right.
So you'll get 10 minutes, and most people have done enough auditions that 10 minutes is enough.
Huh.
Yeah. I also had a question. My friend said I also do a couple voices here and there. Has there ever been a voice where, like, you've done it so much, like, the next day, like, your throat hurts or you can't really do that voice for a while?
That happened today. I was screaming today for about 4 hours of the session. It sounds like I've been screaming today for 4 hours.
Now, has there been, like, any other things you come across, like, either, like, yeah, currently, like, when you're, like what you said, like, when you're watching cartoons with your kids, like, do you, like, hear that, you're like, oh, maybe I can try that, or you just, like, see if you can do that in a way, maybe?
Usually, I don't do that explicitly, but I'll make mental notes of all the voices I hear so that at some point, if somebody says, well, we want a voice that's something like this character from this show, I said, okay. And I probably can't do a perfect impression, but I can at least do something that sounds the same. And then if it doesn't sound exactly the same, it becomes a new and exciting new character.
Okay.
Oh, wow. That's so cool.
Okay. So I think one last question. Do you have a favorite video game and movie? If so, what are they?
Currently, my life revolves around Sonic Boom, not because it's the only thing that I'm doing, but I've read the first 52 episodes of the show. I've seen the first 8 episodes of the show. I'm looking forward to episode 9, which is airing tomorrow morning. I've been very pleased with what I've seen. I was laughing when I was recording it. I laugh even more when I see the finished product. I'm not a gamer, so I can't really pick a favorite game in terms of gameplay. But I remember when the whole big 2010 recasting happened and we started doing Sonic Colors and Sonic Generations, there was quite a lot of comedy happening in those scripts, and there was just a lot of laughter during those recording sessions. So those were an interesting new and exciting direction that they were taking the franchise in, and it was fun to be a part of. And Sonic Boom, having fleshed out the comedy and the beautifully done animations, if I may credit our fine French animation team, that's been a thrill to be part of.
Yeah, so yeah, because I watched a couple of Sonic Boom episodes just to get the gist of it, and it seems like the comedy is not like, you know, your general, you know, here's a joke, laugh. It's more like, because from what I've seen, it's more like you have to think about it sometimes. It's kind of witty in a way, and I appreciate that, because there's a lot of cartoons out there that just kind of, you know, like, here you go. It's not like
poop and fart jokes.
Right, it's like, you know, it shows that, you know, people making those scripts and animations, you know, they think that their audience is more intelligible than what most people think, which I think is very cool, and I appreciate that. So I just want to say that was good on them.
Yeah, it's very much an adult-oriented sitcom, and that makes me proud.
Now, do you think they were trying to get into the block sections with, like, Adventure Time, which is 11 minutes, and regular show? That's 11 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Like, were they going for that kind of thing where it's quick, but it's also, like, very enjoyable to watch in a short amount of time?
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, it's the 11-minute format can be challenging, and I think we've risen to that challenge.
Okay. And is there anything you're looking forward to in the future? Like, even though you might not know what it is there anything you're like, you know, like, that would be cool if that happened?
I'd like to be invited to more conventions for more meet and greets. See people, see what's going on, see what people like the show when I see them in person. Conventions are always fun. And some big screen theatrical film. I've been in some small big screen theatrical films. It's nice to see yourself and hear yourself up in the big screen. But one of those big, real live, full time theatrical films would be very cool.
Like, okay, for the Sonic Boom conventions, how are they? Because I've never really seen it, but I've heard of it. Like, how's it different from Comic-Con and, I guess, like, things like that?
We had one Sonic Boom event that they had the entire Sonic Boom cast, or at least the main characters, come up and do a live thing for 5 hours of fun. That was mind-bogglingly wonderful, mostly because, unlike the anime conventions that I tend to go to, or the gaming conventions, you have fans of lots of different things that are here to see lots of different people, and very often you may not be the thing that most people are interested in seeing, so there are other guests that get longer lines than you do. But at the Sonic Boom event, everybody was there because they were a Sonic fan. Everybody knew who all of us were, and they were all thrilled to see us, thrilled to hear us, and thrilled to meet us when we were autograph table for meets and greets. So that it was such a devoted fan base with one common interest. It was bordering on the overwhelming.
All right, that's really cool. How, and so like the fans, like they're great, like they're nice to be around and all that stuff.
In most cases, they can get opinionated when it comes to the anonymity of the internet, but in person, they tend to be fairly well behaved.
All right, well that's good. Well,
like in the streets, like you walk around like normal, and then when you go to these expos, does it feel good to get noticed by these people?
As an actor, it's great to have audience feedback. Is this thing on?
Sorry about that.
Hi, Ben.
Not a problem. When I'm doing stuff on stage, it's a completely different experience because you've got a live audience in front of you. And when I would be doing plays in school and community theater and wherever else I was doing on stage stuff and doing live events, same kind of thing. You can not only do live improv and ad libs and get laughs, but if you're doing a scripted reading like we did the Sonic Boom event, it's great to hear what people are laughing at, because when we're in the booth and we're recording, we're laughing among ourselves, but you can't really laugh during the take because you're going to ruin the take. Mm-hmm. And if the people are laughing behind the glass, you can't really hear them laughing even though they're laughing behind the glass. So the instant real-time feedback that any good actor craves isn't really available that instantly when you're recording something. So it's nice that the director says, "Hey, that was great." It's like, "Yeah, but where's the laughter?" Well, we laughed while you were doing it. So, yeah, doing a live appearance really adds an extra magical feeling.
That's pretty cool.
So, our friend Donovan, he is looking forward to becoming an actor. Maybe in the future, a voice actor, if that's what he wants to do. But right now, he's going to college to be that. He's taking classes. Is there any advice? Well, not advice. Well, advice that you would like to give him?
Any acting experience is worthwhile if you're going to focus on voice acting, which I consider myself an actor who happens to focus on voice acting and characters because it's what I happen to enjoy and what happens to work best for my strengths and is the most efficient way for me to work. So any acting you can do, community theater is great, school theater is great, take some type of training. I have not had a lot of training, which I think may work to my advantage in some cases, because there are some people whose overtraining just gets in the way.
Okay.
But once you do that, if you want to do voice acting, get yourself a good demo tape. And probably the best thing, the hardest information to give is pay somebody to not only give you some coaching, but also someone who can produce a quality demo tape for you. So you end up with something that's well produced with music and sound effects and nice and tightly edited, and you can have that to shop around because that's essentially your calling card. All
right. I got one question for you. All right. So we figured out that you're not a big Will Ferrell fan. So I have this question.
If he was here, I'd be a huge fan.
Right.
But so what's the one movie that he did that you watched that you were like, you figured out that I'm not a fan of this guy?
It occurs to me that he's probably not a fan of mine, so I can feel individual. have I seen any other Will Ferrell movies? I guess most of his work that I would have seen would have been in his Saturday Night Live days. And some of the sketches were good, but some of them were just annoying and much of the same. Mind you, much of Saturday Night Live can be in itself annoying and too much of the same.
Yeah.
But some of the stuff he did was like, "Look, I'm hitting you over the head with a joke. Look, is this obvious that I'm joking yet?" Like, okay, gotta stop. So probably his SNL work left the lasting impression.
Yeah, oh man. Like, the one thing that his work that he's done that I figured out that I wasn't a fan of was Step Brothers, if you've seen that movie.
I've seen, I think, enough of it to know that. Yeah.
That was a bad movie.
Yeah.
So, going back to when you're reading the script for anything you're working on, is there other people working with you? Because in the Sonic Boom reel, when they first announced it, I think it showed more than one of your coworkers like in one room recording. And I was wondering if that's like a daily thing or was that just like a special event?
For Sonic Boom, in most cases we would record simultaneously, but because they're in LA and I'm in New York, we would not necessarily be in the same time or space. We'd be in the same time, but not in the same space. So I would be in a New York studio, they would all, the rest of them, be in an LA studio, and we would be chatting just like this on the internet so that we could interact in real time and we could act and react as though we were in the same room. But just like doing stuff on the radio, you don't have to see the other person. And just like talking on Skype or talking on the phone, you don't have to see the other person to maintain a conversation. So the radio play, as we record, as we call the voice records.
Okay.
We end up with a real-time performance that then gets animated, and you don't realize that we were nowhere near each other.
Well, that's what I find impressive, is how they're able to edit that together and make it seem like one fluent conversation was going on.
Yeah, and same thing with dubbing stuff. When you're dubbing stuff for foreign language, all the actors come in and record individually so that as they're recording, each line can be tweaked to fit perfectly or as near as perfectly as possible into the space that the lip flap is giving. And they can massage the audio, stretching it, squeezing it, cutting it, while the actor is there without inconveniencing all the other actors who would have to sit and listen for every line while every line gets massaged. So once that is all done and everyone records separately, when you hear it played back, if it's properly assembled, you can't tell that people were nowhere near each other. There was stuff that I did at 4Kids, which was almost exclusively dubbed. And there were people that I didn't meet for months. The Sonic X cast, for example, I didn't meet most of the rest of them for a couple of months into production. So, well, you're the guy who plays Sonic? Wow!
You're my nemesis?
Well, Mike, it was great to have you on. Thank you. Appreciate it. So before you go, just the inner Sonic fan of me has to ask, can you say something in your Dr. Eggman voice before you have to leave?
Sure, I just did. Thank you.
All right. That was great, Mike. All right, thank you for coming on and have a great night.
Thanks for having me.
All right, see ya. All right, so that was Mike Pollock, everyone. So what'd you guys think of that nice gentleman who was very generous to come on our show?
Yeah, Mike seemed like a pretty cool guy. He came on, I'm like, dude, he has a good voice, man.
Yeah, he's I gotta say to everyone, to the universe right now, I have to apologize to Jeremy right now, because I thought he was full of shit when he told me that Mike was coming on, that Dr. Eggman was gonna be a guest. So, I mean, we made a bet that if he was lying, because I was pretty sure he was lying, because it was like, out of nowhere, why would Dr. Eggman come to us? You know, like, guest star on us, and the bet was he'd get me a box of pizza, and I...
Really?
Yeah, if he was lying, but since he wasn't, I have to apologize, and sorry, Jeremy. My bad.
But thank you, Mike, for being on the show.
Yeah, appreciate it. It's very kind of you, because, you know, I think that's special for all of us that you came on, because, you know, when I was a kid, I used to watch the Sonic X shows, and like, oh, dude, this guy, like, just like, the whole cast I thought was great, you know, regardless of what people thought. I was like, what, like 10? So I didn't care. But I mean, besides that, I look back on that, I'm like, you know what? That was pretty cool. So thanks again, Mike. And you know, maybe we could get you on the show again sometime.
Maybe on the show, do a little some, a little extra.
Well, again, sometime again. That's what I meant to say.
Yeah, yeah.
But we'll be back with the podcast. When we come back, Daniel, right? Is he coming?
Daniel Donovan will be here. We'll have the fireside chat going on. And stay tuned for that.
All right, we'll be back.